Ember Spirit later on in the draft, and just the big AoE combo as well.
Maybe they wanted to really hope that maybe gets out of control, and the Bounty Hunter can prevent that.
He even had a pretty decent start last game. He was at least marginally ahead in the mid lane, but it didn't seem to matter when the clutch moments popped up.
Okay, CDEC don't want the same start in their safe lane as last game. Already TPing down and realizing that that Observer Ward, it was just like, okay, we can't pull. What are we supposed to do for the first 5 or 6 minutes of the game? Luckily, ROTK gave them a kill, but without that, they would have just been so underleveled and underfarmed.
Oh man, this vision they have is great off the bat. One Observer Ward up in the Dire Woods. Not something that you generally look to D-Ward.
Did someone TP there to drop that?
I believe TP'd mid and then ran up the river to plant it.
It's a pretty smart move. Now they're almost guaranteed bottom row.
Well, last game it felt like LGD might have had the slightly better warding situation overall in the laning stage, but this game, things looking really nice for CDEC. This is just the standard lane ward up top for the Dire. Yeah, we'll be XE on the offlane Darkseer here. Curious to see where Garter looks to go and which lane they want to pressure. Generally, that Nightstalker Darkseer do work together once the first Knight hits, as the horn will sound and we're underway. Game 2, LGD versus CDEC has begun.
Is Siler actually going mid?
Guess so. Yeah, he's got a little money saved up here. So they are going to run the Dazzle Bristle dual lane, potentially, at least starting with the creep block mid for now. This does leave RTK in the offlane Shaker, something that has not really worked much this tournament, Ben. It feels like you just kind of forfeit the lane to the enemy carry and they get free farm. A lot of teams have started to shy away from it.
Yeah, it's just very hard to do anything as the Earthshaker aside from block creeps.
Garter already exchanging some blows here with DDC, gets the Shadow Wave off, but just keeps on going anyway. Because there is a little pursuit onto Xe in the top lane of the Darkseer. Everybody's skirmishing. Siler, the one that might be in trouble, though, being chased down the river by Cheeky. Has this level 2, there is a salve. Really looking to pressure. He's going to commit that blink and dives even further onto Siler, looking for the first blood. Up the cliff he goes. He is going to salve, but the auto attack cancels it. Siler's in all kinds of trouble. He ticks down to the poison. And Cheeky gets off to a hot start mid. What the hell just happened there?
Just a long chase by them. I was actually initially wondering why they would pair the Bristleback and the Dazzle versus the Queen of Pain as opposed to the Lina. I guess maybe they thought that they couldn't secure Bristleback's farm versus the Darkseer Island Shell, but I mean, Queen of Pain is just free to buy a magic stick and have her way in the mid lane, and especially with that Observer Ward already up there to see what exactly is going on with their support line. This is just the time of Cheeky's life.
Yeah, Cheeky, not often known for really dominating the lane, unless he has that Lina and occasionally the Queen of Pain in the right matchup, but he's off to a hot start now. Should have a much easier time. Already the 4 denies as well. So looking at the other lanes, it is an offlane Darkseer. Ben really not being contested here, already level 3. RTK struggling a bit more, has hit 2.5 though.
He might come under trouble at the rune.
Looks like he will, the Void's there. There is no TP scroll, he's gonna have to run away the good old fashioned way, but the Arctic Bird ticks in. There will be another Void soon. RTK may also go down, looks for the fissure into the trees and will escape. But it is gonna cost him a lot of regen and may even have to go back to base, we'll see. For now he's camping mid. Maybe he tries to turn this mid lane around. Cheeky does still have that ward, but it won't see RTK. Meanwhile, XE, well, he's kind of caught out here, but just keeps on sprinting to the right. He will get stunned out, maybe off the mark there. XE, Surge cooling down, has the salve available. Maybe with another save, it's only level 1, and with the poison touch, should be enough for the kill. LGD do strike back, but that one forces a 4 hero rotation as RTK has just entirely abandoned this bottom lane for now.
And MMY is just a beast on the Tusk. That Ice Charge forcing him to run all the way right and allowing him to be cut off by the mid laners. Nice placement.
You know, Tusk is a pretty damn good hero, but there are good Tusk players and there are great ones, and MMY is definitely in the great ones.
There is those like places in the match where like, there's no way they can lock me in with the Ice Shards here.
And then it's like, he just like we turned into an architect and just built the perfect prison. You're just crying, sobbing.
ROTK.
Softly in your sleep.
The struggles continue.
Yeah, this is just the offlane Shaker in action. If he doesn't get any help, how is he supposed to stay in the lane?
At least he hasn't died yet.
That's true. But you compare this to the Darkseer. XE, level 4, isn't being pressured either. And it feels like there's kind of this cascade effect from that early first blood with two heroes now committed to the mid lane. And they're not really shutting down Cheeky whatsoever. Even in CS, still with the Bristleback. Ancient's not being stacked yet, something that we do often see, although they do have a single double stack up on the big camp here towards the mid lane. So the lane's looking really good for C-Dike early on.
And Aggressive is getting free farm as opposed to maybe who has had to, you know, lead the lane a little bit to try and help the Tusk pressure to Darkseer and has to deal with the Ion Shell. And Ion Shell's not easy as a range hero.
And it's Ion Shell with Ember and Nightstalker, like two of the best heroes just run at you and cause havoc. And they're getting their early levels as well.
And this Observer Ward early just peeks into DDC while he's stacking too.
Cheeky wants to contest Sylar here. He's gonna walk into a snowball. Blinks out, charge, beautiful, almost. Just barely failing to wrangle him in. That could have been a kill and a much needed one as well, but Cheeky is gonna suffer here for the region now. Being denied that rune is the Bristleback grabs one. Garter forced to take the bounty rune away from the...
You said beautiful before he'd even hit.
I was expected. Like, I pushed him out. It was like right there.
Yeah,
I caught myself then. Come on. You throw me under the bus, man.
Well, you do expect MMY to hit those.
Yeah.
That, I mean, he has some nice
moves. I think that was just Dota having mercy on Cheeky. That's my theory, anyway.
Oh, nighttime hits. Stack is not yet taken by LGD. And with Darkseer, Ember, and Queen in the game, we have to wonder whether or not CDEC are going to smoke up there at some point, or at least run in there with a Nightstalker. And scout what's going on. Now it's looking to be a quad stack.
Ember is now level 6. He's got the jump potential here in RTK. No teleports in LGD. And they do have the lane ward as well, so they see him under the tower. This is the easiest possible kill if he gets caught. But for now, RTK is going to lunge back and hide.
They don't have vision around there.
Well, they do have the... Oh, you mean for LGD?
No, Z-Deck don't have...
Well, they have the lane ward, so they saw
it doesn't, him. It doesn't see that
it
far.
It just barely saw him, but now he's backed off.
Oof.
RTK very far back. And Garter pressing in. He's got the level 1 silence as well here. Now DDC is rotated, though. He senses that Z-Deck may want to go.
Yeah, but they have three heroes there now.
And there are now three TPs. It hits nighttime, and LGD are like, okay, we need to be ready for this. Good adjustment by them. The chains are going to come through, interrupting the fissure. RTK manages to get it off, but now they look to die. Just kidding. They force the TP. They back off. MMY now has to rotate, and Garter looks to retreat, but they're looking to cut him off here. Sylar, oh, actually, just wants the rune. The whole team hunting Garter, but Sylar is not.
Oh, he has no goo. Viscous Sneasel goo.
Sounds about as disgusting as it is. I mean, this is feeling like the dream start for C-Dick, though. They got their fast levels and farm on the Ember. Already, your Darkseer has the level 3 Ion Shell. In fact, has cracked 6. Cheeky had a pretty solid start mid, continues to do fine and get his levels. Nightstalker slipping a little bit in the experience department, but they're basically online now. All their key heroes.
Yep, Ember hits that level 7 mark and is just really, really scary with Ion Shell plus Flame Guard. That can break the game wide open, barring great plays from Tusk and perhaps Lina.
And LGD definitely fearful of that aggression. They plant two wards near the mid lane, both rather defensive ones.
Yeah, but that won't save you from like Ion Shell TP into Remnant. So they have to be there with bodies, not only with vision.
That's where the TPs come into play, and they now have 4. They're definitely fearing the aggression, but it's not really coming from C-Deck for now. They're content to farm, push out the lanes. Looks like they may try to reapply some pressure bottom. As Aggressive, Garter, and Q all congregate. Still Cheeky sitting mid, but he's also ready to teleport if duty calls.
They're severely lacking levels on their supports, though. Both the Nightstalker and the Winter Wyvern are only level 3 from LGD.
Yeah, there's a slight advantage here for LGD if they've got 1 up to 4 in that Tusk. But then I guess that is somewhat balanced up on RTK struggling as they get off the Void. Aggressive, they give out the dive here, but while that was happening, maybe does find a kill. They're going to commit onto RTK, they will get him. So they lose the Darkseer top, but they grab the kill bottom lane.
And he still has the Ion Shell on a creep, so it's still going to push out the lane a little bit.
One for one there, though, so the Darkseer being slowed down.
But they get to, that's the benefit of having the Darkseer. Like, generally, even when you die the lane, you won't lose your tower. Which is pretty darn nice, and one of the deficiencies of Earthshaker.
While that's going on, Ancients are being stacked here. Just a double stack for now. And C-Deck are going to get right into this. They drop the ward. They will not let the Bristleback grab anything for free. MMY on the hunt.
LGD already know, though. They saw him place it, and they pinged it out.
I'm just looking at the posture of Aggressive. He's living up to his name here. Posted up way on the bottom lane, not afraid of getting ganked, and that is a concern for LGD. They don't have the easiest initiation on the Ember Spirit.
So maybe working on his way to the Yules. Is their team fight really that good? I guess maybe if Bristle is in a really good position or is able to spray a lot of quills.
You've got Shaker, Tusk, so I guess you can never say the team fight's bad, but it's more, can you really hit that, you know, 3-4 hero fissure
and counter
snowball?
The vacuum into Winter's Curse combo.
Right, that's the thing, you roll in against a Wyvern. Well, I mean, he's nowhere near level 6, but once he gets it, the punish is there. Very, very static laning stage again after the early rotations. It's been a pretty passive series for both teams, but it looks like aggressive. Maybe he looks to change that up as RTK lurches forward bottom. No, he's too scared. He's not going to move out. The same happening top. Garter just hugging his tower. It's maybe he's going to push in the lane now. These teams are just not really in any hurry to fight.
Nope, still looking for level 6 from supports. If you're CDZ, ideally you want to fight, like, you know, under nighttime or with the help of darkness, and that's still not going to come for a couple of minutes. LGD looking to make a move with the Tusk.
Well, as you mentioned, it is now daytime. Could be a good opportunity to go for that kill. Maybe with the phase boots grabbed up here, a little extra mobility for him. XZ, the man that might get caught, there's the snowball. Shards will follow, trapping XZ, and he drops the wall, quickly gets zapped. And the grill and will drop. MMY though is the trade. One for one, they're looking for more. Ember arrives, they want to track down maybe here. The two carry players want to duke it out. But Aggressive is going to get the upper hand, brings him down. They did manage to lose the Nightstalk on the other end of the fight, but Aggressive now finds his footing. He charges forward onto Sylar. Not an easy hero to take down, but he's going to try for it. That Flame Guard's wearing off soon though. Don't think he can actually get this kill on his own. He'll need some assist. And Cheeky has the ultimate. He's trying to bait them in. Aggressive does do it. Cheeky heading onto the ult. Heading onto the ult some more. Can he turn on Sylar? No blank. He's going to have to long ball it here. If he goes, Ember buying back, re-engaging. No slight offense. He gets off the chains just barely. The Quap ult's there. It's just enough damage with the chains. And Aggressive now finds himself on the wrong side of a fissure, or perhaps the right side, because he keeps on running in. In the end, will be forced back. That was a very early buyback. You get the Iron Chill up, though, and they look for more. MMY's next, backed into the burning swords of Aggressive. Will find the kill. Well, an early buyback, Ben, but it does result in two extra kills.
I think that was worth it for him in the end. Without the kill on the toss, I don't think it would have been worth it, but they end up killing the Lina too, which is a pretty big deal. Slowing down her Yules is imperative, and she has to get a Yules versus like the Night Stalker, who's going to be able to silence her up very early on in fights.
They also got their level 6 on Q in part off of that fight, so now they have the Winter's Curse.
Still a very delayed mech coming out from XZ because of the three
lane. Aggressive just toying with maybe here. Doesn't have the Remnants available, or he could have gone for that. It does drop him quite low. Well, a little bit of aggression. And now we see an early grab of the Vanguard for Sylar. So are you expecting the full Crimson Guard this game?
It's okay versus Sleight of Fist, but other than that, I might need to build more support items. I don't think they have a mech coming out on their team soon. Usually MMY builds the mech, but he doesn't even have his Arcane Boots yet.
Yeah, he's pretty poor. So you think skip that and go for the mech maybe, then an AC or something like that? BKB?
I mean, I think eventually you want to finish up the Crimson Guard, but maybe like an SNY or a mech first.
Gotcha.
Before. But I think Crimson Guard is okay here. Versus the like Winter's Curse, I think it's pretty useful. Darkseer wall.
We'll see if that's the choice. For now, Sylar saving up a bit of gold. The Dire Squad did manage to get off into the Radiant Jungle. And they planted down a relatively deep Observer Ward. They did it at night as well, so kind of a risky maneuver, but ends up paying off. I'll see Aggressive pushing in that top lane. No, not going to see any boots of travel. Just went for the very early treads. And now I believe has the drums on the way on the courier. And DD does, so kind of your typical Aggressive build. There is a roll in the bottom lane. No big snowball dive from MMY, but he's gone too far. He's been baited in deep, and now he manned up dropping. They get the curse ult with the back combo from XZ. Beautifully played. The Splinter Blast coming in as well. And now Aggressive is starting to get in range for the fight, maybe. Caught out turns, but they'll go to Echo as well. Big commitment, but Ember arrives, locks onto RDK, tries for the TP out. Is there a way to cancel this? The back's pulling out. Ember dumping in deeper. Shiki's joining the fray as well. This is C-Deck. playing their classic aggression, and once more, it does pay off. A 3-for-1.
Wow, that teamwork from them, too. They just, as soon as they saw the Lina in a bad position, boom, Winter's Curse, everyone just turns on her and just kills her. If they didn't have that quick of a turn on her, Grave would have come in on the Dazzle and said they were able to just kill maybe and keep slowing down his Yule Scepter. He wasn't even able to spend his unreliable gold before he died.
It just seems like LGD are not ready for the diving that's coming as bottom lane. There is a jump onto RTK and burned down by the Ion Shell. Flame Guard once more. C-Deck just styling on LGD, and it's really feeling like they don't have control for this Ember. He may even go back in. Maybe he's TP'd in. Is there a dodge on the snowball? No, he still gets caught. Punch. Do they have to follow up? Not just yet. Able to zip away. Space created for the rest of the team.
Yeah, he's kind of pushing the hero to the limit, forcing them to, you know, TP in, save, and if not for the Tusk, I think Lina would have died there.
How do they deal with this position in the game now?
They had to play a lot smarter during nighttime. You had a Tusk solo snowballing someone during nighttime, and this is pretty close to their T1 without their T1 up, so they're desperate for getting kills so they can make their way back into the game, and they don't want it to end up how it was last game, where aggressive just farms out of control and eventually just dominates their whole team. So instead, they're trying to make some more aggressive moves, but you know, it's nighttime. Night Stalker's already level 6, it's just not the best time to do so.
Well, the knight still a little bit left here. Garter has managed to crack level 7.
Managed to see a smoke up in the, near the mid lane. LGD making their way to the jungle.
Unfortunately for them, there won't be any heroes to find, but perhaps they can at least grab the tier 1. It'll be a bit slow going, though. Not the strongest pushing lineup here. Ideally, they would like to find that pick first, but it's not coming. Grasif, meanwhile, is going to look to cut the wave mid, perhaps, starting to work on that tier 1 together with Shiki. The two big carry players.
They kind of just always ignore the Bristleback. They know that his mobility can't be matched, or his mobility can't match the Ember Spirit, so they get the Ember Spirit to kind of roll
on Shiki, and Shiki is gone. A little giggle there from Alina.
Yeah, just underestimation of the Earthshaker's initiation range. The Fissure into other stun combo is the one that just catches so many people off guard. You're like, okay, I can see, it's nighttime, I feel pretty comfortable, and then boom, Fissure from like 1500 range away.
Yeah, and so they see the roll mid, they lose their Lina, or their Puy to Pain to the Lina rather, and they're like, okay, great, let's smoke right now, fight at the bottom lane. There's just no stopping C-Deck from going for these kills. RTK will get caught out the Void, as well as the Sans deployed, and also dead. Kill number 7, aggressive, continues to ramp up, and now hunting for Siler. He's cursed, surrounded and beaten down. His own illusion even turned against him. Well, as quickly as they get the one kill, C-Deck hunting for more, aggressive, charging forward, doesn't have the chains for a few seconds, has an additional remnant, could commit for this one. Actually, it's two available. Chains are there, grabs maybe once more, and then does pass them towards MMY, even looking for another kill. Now I'll settle for that. But again and again, C-Deck just keep on punishing LGD.
That window for them was so small in order to catch out those two heroes on the bottom lane. ROTK was set in a position that he could like fissure and cover Siler's track if they wanted to run away. But again, the Bristleback is kind of the hero that has been isolated. He hasn't really been in line in the front line. You need him in front so that the Night Stalker and the Ember Spirit can't just walk
on. Another dive. ROTK, he's in pretty far here. Aggressive drops the remnant behind him, but then pops the jump charge, runs forward. He's got the escape plan available. They look to lock him down. They commit the echo. No, he sips away. Houdini faking it out, even dodging the shards which were chasing him.
Oh my.
He's just playing with
LGD. I think that was like 11 or 12 HP.
I'm not sure he planned it quite that way, but it just feels like the story of this game. Everything's working for the man.
Yeah, he's been playing very, very well. Just all up in their face all the time.
Are you a little surprised they got the Emperor last pick?
Yes,
with the champ they already had?
Well, from their mindset, it's like, wow, the PL, we thought we had a good lineup for the PL, and we still lost to him. Why don't we just ban it out to be safe? But it, from an objective point of view, it did seem like Ember was a much better pick. It's much better suited for this type of game. There's no direct counters to him, great synergy with Ion Shell, and a natural aggressive hero.
Well, LGD, looking for the comeback now, are going to make their way into the Roche Pit.
I think they should give it to Maybe, though, instead of Siler. Just because Siler hasn't really...
Like you said, he just gets piped.
Threatened.
Yeah. And ignored, largely. Well, they grab the Aegis. Time for C-Deck to charge in, seems to be the call. Alright, they'll think about it. They were looking for that fight. If LGD walk up the ramp, they definitely would have gone.
Well, they wanted to see if anyone was low, but they aren't because of Urn and Dazzle Heal.
They still have the Lane Ward mid. So they want to try and swing around for a sideswipe here. It doesn't look like it. Top lane is beginning to push, though, and that tower very low. So they're going to sit four that way. Aggressive will hold the mid line. He's closing out on the Battle Fury now.
But now Cedic are just looking for opportunities where Bristleback isn't there. But now that there's not as many options because Lina has the Aegis, and she's actually getting her farm in finally.
If the teams just trade farm and this goes later, do you see much hope for LGD being able to take it at that point?
I mean, Bristle, we saw how difficult it was for them to take it out on bottom. They even committed to Wall and the Winter's Curse on a 4v1 situation just because they're scared of this damage output. And combine that with the Dazzle Weave, those Quill Sprays are just going to do immense amounts of damage. So you can't kite him forever. Eventually, like, if he's getting tired of getting kited, he'll just get a BKB or, you know, they'll get 4 stabs and Glimmer Cave so that he can kind of do what he wants. But now LGD, they're in a very, very good formation. It's like, okay, Siler's up in front and our weak supports, especially ROTK without the blink, are protected.
It definitely seems like LGD is the team that wants the organized fight with the kind of clunkier, slower heroes like the Earthshaker and Dazzle, the Bristle who needs to be tanking, where CDEC have these ultra-mobile backstabbing type heroes.
Especially with the darkness. That's I think their main key
top lane
with these fights later.
RTK has been backed, silence, and should be taking down here with the Soulburn. Drops indeed, and Cheeky grabs another kill. This has not been the best series for RTK so far. That crucial pickoff when he was mid for Darkseer last game, and he's dying quite a few times here as well.
Well, I kind of liked how XZ played the last game. He wasn't getting that much from the lane. He played very safely, and then he tried to just fizzle from long range and get killed until he had his Blink Dagger. But ROTK instead has been trying to farm his way into his Blink as opposed to kill and then farm.
Rather than let them come to him.
Yeah, it's not a good path for Earthshaker, only having 1,000 gold right now. I mean, Nightstalker is already going to be able to fight him out pretty easily, and then combined with the fact that he doesn't have a blink, and Garter may have a scepter, fight it like maybe 5-10 minutes after he gets his blink, and echoes are going to be hard to find.
And especially with the Night Vision and the Ember Spirit in the game, just so good at catching him out. Do you see maybe Invis right now?
I mean, even like the Orchid coming out too, or like an instant Winter's Curse following an echo.
They have just a lot of ways to shut him down.
But CDEC might have forced him into this position, though. They last banned out the Clockwork, fully expecting an ROTK hero to be last.
They definitely know their LGD, and you know, that's where some teams do run the offlane Tusk, but MMY is always the Tusk, and it's always a support, so
ROTK plays it occasionally.
Yeah, not this tournament, though. I think every game that they've run at this event, it has been MMY. I mean, certainly he's been magnificent on the hero. It's tough to argue with it, but does maybe tip your hand a bit more as far as the draft goes. So LGD group up 5 top. This Aegis has about a minute and a half or so. Do you think CDEC look for a fight, or do they just push away?
Not this top tower. This top tower is just not good positioning for them. They are just not set up. Like, maybe you go for a wraparound, but I think they're really waiting for the Darkseer Blink Dagger. And then once they have that, they can fight, because they'll coincide with the time of the Aegis expiring on Lina. So, what, 1 minute left? That's okay. You're in a pretty comfortable position if you're CDEC, and you don't have to take this fight. The T1 tower doesn't really mean that much to you right now. It's not like it's controlling your jungle. It's not like CDEC are farming Ancients. So.
And now Aggressive is Battle Fury. Cheeky up to 1600 gold. As you mentioned, the Darkseer Blink online. So they've gotten a couple of key items during this time.
But what this will mean is that CDEC, their aggression was stalled because of the Aegis. So like come, you know, 5, 6, 7 minutes from now, they're going to be really concerned about protecting the area, warding it up, maybe throwing a remnant in there, because that's kind of been their only wrench in their plans this entire game.
They are on the smoke now. Nighttime has fallen for a bit, and they are hunting. Garter?
They see Siler mid, and they're immediately like, okay, we can pick off these weak supports behind or find anyone else, because he's somewhat isolated. And there's a very small window in between where he's going to hook up to the rest of his team, but looks like they won't find that.
They don't have aggressive with them. I think they were banking on that push mid and then go for the 5-man surround, but didn't actually materialize. Instead, LGD swing towards the bottom lane now. They do. Siler being scouted out here. It's going to be 4 minutes until the next Roshan respawn, so this will be a window for CDEC if they don't want to fight into the pit to fight before it spawns.
Oh, we see a smoke from LGD on from behind. I don't know if it was under the Observer Ward, but it might have been.
Oh, XZ, such a crucial here to get Coppity Blinks out. They're going to slowly chase after Garter. The Gouda stack up, but this will give time for Cedic to prep on the high ground.
I think they saw Psylar.
And they leave aggressive and reserve. He chains out the Earthshaker, who doesn't have a blink just yet. Very close to it. A shot in the dark from MMY, but doesn't find anyone with the shard. Cedic, they got to the high ground. They have the AoE combo, and LGD just don't want to risk it.
A good use of darkness, though. They won't have vision to, like, let's say, Snowball or Eels combo somebody. And Earthshaker's actually really close to blink now, just 50 gold away.
No, looks like RTK should be able to grab it with this wave. Chucks out the fissure, and there's the blink. We saw last game, the blink on Earthshaker can just completely change the game, even if it's only a one hero echo. Could be the death of Aggressive, who they desperately need to kill. Psylar is scouted out in the river, but Aggressive is busy cutting off the backline. Isolates DDC, and C-Deck will retreat.
They don't have vision. They don't know if the Shaker has blink right now. It's about that time, and you want to be able to find him out so you can at least orc him.
So LGD stay clumped up in the mid lane, and I guess at this point they're just waiting for the next Roshan.
Well, they need to keep their farm up too. Psylar needs to keep on doing ancient stacks, and it's daytime, so they have a little bit more movement around the map. So they just need to make sure that they don't fall too far behind in terms of farm.
On the mid lane they go. They are going to curse Psylar. They're committing for this one, but they don't have the full team here.
They know that Urshaker has a point. They all split up.
Oh, the chain was there, interrupting LGD's jump forward as Aggressive rolls back. The snowball coming in. MMY, they want to turn on him now. Quickly burst him down if possible. Silent. There's the back. The wall. My god, my kingdom for a curse. They don't have it. Maybe they don't need it. The scream and the slide of fist almost finished up two of those squishy backlighters. And now Remnant forward. Aggressive out for blood. Hot on the trail. Will bring down DDC. Another pickoff. Psylar may have survived, but the rest of the team is in shambles. The C-Deck is completely outmaneuver LGD again.
Again, it's all aggressive. Firstly, he's on the high ground, so they get vision of the Shaker, so they see his blink. Secondly, he baits the snowball into, like, the Indian Ancients so that they're forced to fight on the terms they don't really want to. After that, he slide a fist the Earthshaker so he can't blink, and then all of them just converge after they get sight from the slide of fist
imagine
to drop
if they,
a vacuum.
Imagine if they had Winter's Curse there. That's a five-man wipe, probably.
That was just
scary.
Aggressive just doing all the right things for his team. Getting vision and pulling them into a bad position is no easy feat.
Well, maybe it showed off an incredible Ember Spirit at TI5, but Aggressive says two can play at that game, and he's even going to go the same build here. Grabs the early Blink Dagger. Something might maybe really paved the way for back at that event.
But that's LGD's best shot. It's daytime, there's no darkness, and you just got the Blink Dagger. Like, when you don't have any of those tools, the last tool left is Aegis. Without the Aegis, they have no chance of winning a fight realistically.
And it is so risky to go into the pit against this combo.
I mean, but what else do you do? If you wait for Nightfall, darkness is already up. And there's, 100 seconds left until darkness. So half of that will be taken up by Nightstalker's ultimate. And then after that, you have to wait for
Aggressive jumps in mid, and okay, back he goes. Thought he didn't have a remnant there for a second, but he is prepared as always. So yeah, that Roshan, if it is the next objective, it's coming soon. Only looks like maybe 15 seconds or so to go. But there's a catch mid on Psylar. Not going to follow that one up. Any moment now, the big rock will be back.
Yeah, but it's about time to pop darkness. You might as well pop it at 27:10, and then when it ends, it'll be 28, and then nighttime for the next four. And then that's the time that I think, and as well as all their ultimates cooling down. So this is about the time for them to try and seal the deal.
Well, they're going to send the Ember Spear towards top, trying to bait somebody back as the tower just gets chipped away on creeps and nobody comes to defend. Maybe Cedic going to start to suspect that Roshan might be in the cards. They'll clear out the wave.
Yeah, they're not actually in position to defend it, though. But at least they'll get a 2-2 at a minimum. And they're actually grouping up for a smoke right now.
Well, tower will die to creep, so Garcia plays it safe, is going to back off. Rest of the team waiting for their carry player to rejoin them.
It's a little bit slow. Like, LGD, they potentially could have taken Roche. It would have been super YOLO and super risky, but that's kind of like their only chance.
Their position,
Their position kind of demands that they have to take that sort of risk.
There is a ward that's scouted on RTK, and in fact, the way that they've traveled, they might run straight into the freight chain that his LG, or that is C-Deck, and they jump in. It's RTK caught out again. Then the Remnant forward from Aggressive, already looking for the second kill. He knows the first one's secured. They chase forward on the Psylar, up to the high ground. The BKB's come out. Beautiful club connection. easy kills left and right here for CDEC as they jump forward. Another remnant, another grab. There's the chains. DDC down as well. Four have fallen. It's about to be five. The curse! It wasn't even needed, and now it's deployed onto Sylar. Tries to run to the well. Can't make it out. Chopped armadillo for dinner. And this just might be the end. LGD, everywhere they go. CDEC are 20 steps ahead of them.
They do a really good job of playing around the Bristleback, though. And, I mean, we've seen very few Bristlebacks without Wisp, but when they are picked, it's usually, like, in an offensive dual lane with a Dazzle plus Bristle to put some pressure on the enemy carry, or it's versus a Broodmother. And this is one of the biggest weaknesses of the hero. Like, he's, if you're the last one alive and you can't put out enough pressure, he's kind of useless. They just ran by him. All his supports are very, very poor. And if he farms out alone, his team can't take a fight because there's not that BB frontline.
They just don't seem to have the tools to shut down the Ember Spirit at this point. 11-1-7. He's been in on 18 out of 22 kills. And he's kept up his farm, sitting very close to the Bristleback. He's had four heroes behind him most of the game. Very impressive showing, and now they're going to move over towards the Dire Ancients. Cressif will farm those as well. CDEC using the map well here, keeping their economy going even after a great team fight, and the graphs reflect it, shooting up to over a 14,000 gold lead, similar on the experience.
Aggressive is just advantage. Really good about not dying, though. Like, some carry players will try and make these plays and then just give away one or two deaths, which will just, you know, nullify all of your hard work because of how high on net worth he is. But Aggressive is just, he only did that one time in mid where he fought back, and here we go with the last blow. They already have Remnant in there, though. It's sitting behind. I don't even know if...
They do see it, looking at Sylar's vision, but they're not reacting to it. They're still working on it. They're almost begging CDEC to come, and I think CDEC are going to oblige. They've got the combo up. LGD are not actually scouted up that hill, but you know CDEC expect them to be in the neighborhood. So in the end, LGD are going to have to back down. And now a blink on Q. Even more ways to find that dominant team fight that just spells doom for LGD.
Yeah, they don't have eyes on Nightstalker. They don't know if he actually has his
look at Aggressive. The two hero chains. They were trying to deward and he set up the fight. The team's gonna follow. They snowball and try to hang on. The back was committed. They still have a wall. They still have a curse here. They need the combo. Finishes up DDC. There's the echo from RTK. But they need more backup. They've jumped into the curse. And Sylar's burning. The Ion Shell's bringing him down. He's almost dead. A blink, a scream. He tries to run, but the vampire's on the hunt. And elsewhere, Aggressive was looking to dive a little bit further. Sylar diving, retreating down the mid lane, wants to get the hell away. Four heroes streaming after him. Finally, they'll bring him down. Another death here for LGD. It looks like they had the good counter initiative from RTK, but there's just too many ways to turn the fight for CDEC.
It's actually crazy. It doesn't matter what hero Aggressive is, he always is able to start off the fight. Ember Spirit.
And survive, apparently.
It doesn't matter. Well, that was a really good winner's curve.
New hero chains, and then the follow-up comes from Q. He caught out maybe as well. They're looking to go on this. The back's there. They slow him down. They poke at him. He's going to throw out the Yule Scepter, trying to hang on to his own life, but Aggressive is into the fray again. He gets the chains once more. CDEC just keep on punching LGD, and they can't seem to take the beating. Cheeky, though. He'll go down at least. Something. A consolation prize. They get off the fissure, looking for more. Beautiful enchant toad. RTK is going to turn this fight. They've dropped two. They might lose XC. Gets off the surge. The chase continues. They have a blink soon, fissure available, but already the Darkseer's backing off. Q up on the high ground will also retreat, and they're not going to pursue any further. So in the end, they do force off the buyback there on the Bristleback, gets a couple of kills for the team, but only a small consolation as they're unable to bring down this out-of-control Ember.
And at this point, you kind of have to go for Roche. You are so far behind that you need two lives on Bristleback in order to maybe even think about winning a large-scale 5-on-5.
And already he's scouting it. Lucian's immediately into the pit. This guy just... No quarter is given by Aggressive this game. The series. XC tried to back Sylar up into the high ground. They do lock him down, but he's sleight of fist, dodging away from the chip totem, and then jumps out. The snowball dragging him away from the main engagement. The main engagement happens to the south, where XC's been caught out. He blinks out. The Glimmer Cape used to keep him alive, and now the Axe is up on the Nightstalker. So the vision game will tip dramatically towards CDEC from here
and
on.
And now he's bought enough time for all the heroes to revive. Two on the side of CDEC, one on the side of LGD.
And he's catching them as well. He's jumped one. Sylar, not the easiest target to bring down. Into the pit he goes. But like you said, Ben, they're all back now, and they've got the combo, the back into curse.
Still no wall, though, so maybe not really willing to take the fight. They still have a good amount left on nighttime. 3 minutes left, so just they're not in really that big of a rush. And as you said, the Nightstalker Axe is just going to prove even more problematic for Urshaker. I thought Urshaker had a good ult last game. The only problem was he didn't get the Winter Wyvern, and then the Winter Wyvern cursed the Bristleback, which forced the Urshaker to run over and start beating on him.
It is the power of this type of draft. You've got so many ways to turn the fight. If you don't catch the Ember, he can maybe just kill you. Obviously, that Wyvern or Darkseer can really interrupt things, and it's just been hard for LGD to find that picture-perfect fight. They are looking for it now on the move. They smoked. But C-Deck don't get caught aggressive. Blakes in. He drops the Sleight of Fist in the middle of the trees, and that zips down, thwarting LGD at every possible turn. They have managed to lock in XZ, but do they really want to go? Cheeky's up on the high ground. There's the curse. The back as well. Get ready for some AoE. They buy back the Queen of Pain, and they're going to look to run forward. Aggressive flashing his way through DDC. Beyond Godlike. Somebody kill this guy. Finally, they get the job done. It's a big commitment, but LGD desperately needed that. Unfortunately, it may cost them their Sylar. He turns his back, still takes the crossbow, and into the fray again. They killed him once. Aggressive Remnant T4, the Echo, not quite connecting on him, and now he's going to find two more. Gets the chance on RTK, brings him down as well. Four heroes dead. C-Deck, no mercy once again. Even when you think LGD have a good fight, they still get punished.
That was pretty good. They caught Cheeky out without his BKB.
It was a gold loss here, but the lanes are now pushing against LGD, and C-Deck might even look for a lane of Rags.
I admire how LGD take the fight outside the base, though. If C-Deck aren't all there, or if Winter Wyvern doesn't have a blink, let's say they get an easy pick, and then they sneak out a Roche, and then they still have a fighting chance.
BKB up now in the Lino. We'll see if that makes a difference. C-Deck, though, trying to bait out these 5x. They're not going to be forthcoming. Tusk will respawn soon, so it doesn't want to use his, but crucially, the Bristleback is not available. They will deploy the Weave here, making C-Deck a little more squishy. Maybe. Being given a bit of bonus armor from the Medallion as C-Deck continue to slice away at objectives. Just poking on the melee. They're going to dive onto maybe. BKB forced out. And he will back off, but that's the 10-second. Down the drain, C-Deck chains it again, but this time it's a kiting maneuver. They're not actually looking for kills. RTK, Blake forward, got the Fissure to start this one off. The Enchant Totem attempts an MMY jumping in, but Aggressive looks to turn and punish. Gets the chains up, there's the grid. LGD, they've got the whole gang back now. Looks like C-Deck really need to get out, and none. Aggressive wants to go back in. Typical. Okay, now it's back. Good job covering the retreat.
Queen of Pain's actually fallen a little behind in terms of farm, already behind the Lina, but still, Bristleback, if not really accounted for, will stack up on his sprays. He was able to do a ton of damage in the last fight, especially with a Weave up.
Yeah, it definitely feels like they want to be playing those long fights with the Dazzle, the Bristle. C-Deck very much about that big combination, the back, the wall, the curse, and the Ember Spirit over the top.
Yeah, they really have to have a good echo, though, on ROTK. Too many times he's been hit by Splinter Shards or a Sleight of Fist, usually, and just been unable to connect on the Blink Echo.
And is there, like, an item he could buy that could make a difference?
Some people like Shadow Blade, but he is just way too farmed. Generally, the progression is, like, Blink Force into Shadow Blade if you're having a lot of trouble jumping, but smokes work okay, too. I don't know if they have any smokes left. Doesn't look like it. But, I mean, with the Nightstalker Axe, what realistically can you do?
We'll see if they have any answers. LGD did complete their Sulcurus now on Sylar. Pretty big pickup there for the Bristleback. Also managed to grab the Solar Crest on the Dazzle, so he does become very tanky. We saw last fight just how difficult the guy is to bring down.
Yeah, they just have to be really patient and wait for CDEC to, like, slightly overcommit on the Bristleback and have a lapse in positioning and try and wait for maybe a three-man clump and then just be really quick about dumping your spells.
Well, with the buybacks having been used up on their two carries, C-Deck really want the extra life that an Aegis provides. And they're going to walk into the pit and try to grab it now. Stylar? I think he may have walked in Vision of the Spirit. Yeah, looks like they did scout him, but they're going to back off instead. Very safe play, knowing that the buybacks are on cooldown. Though, to be fair, they still have a tier 1 up bit, so it's not like a lane of racks will be easy for LGD.
Well, staying in the pit will open them up for a Blink Echo Slam, or like a Fissure into a Blink Echo, which would just be really bad for them.
They did get a Blink on MMY at long last. He's definitely struggled a bit more on the Tusk this game. 2-7, not his usual performance. but maybe he can go in first and just let RTK kind of sit back, wait for the right opening as the Bristle charges in. It's going to reveal smoke. Cheeky quickly there with the Shadow Strike, but they really want these backlighters aggressive, trying for it from the high ground. Didn't get the chains off, though, and now Q jumps in. Beautiful curve there. Catches out two here. Then the wall. The back combos on the combo comes through. They bring down DDC. Now Hunty on the maybe. RTK once again doesn't get anything off. He's silenced, and then suddenly he's dead. So it's going to be up to Sylar and MMY as they also lose their Lina. Ember Spear just zipping above in the heavens, and now finds the chains, jumping onto Sylar, not looking so tanky after all, trying to back off low, but they continue to fight, control him, silence Remnants forward, and they get it done. 4-5 hits the deck. C-Deck again and again, just outfighting LGD, better initiation, better vision,
GG,
and just a flawless performance here, 2-0-ing LGD, Big Brother has met his maker.
It takes a lot of discipline to just completely ignore the Bristleback. We saw the Ember Spirit, like, slide a fist of two heroes to the left. We saw the Night Stalker wrap around to the back and isolate the Earthshaker. They just did an excellent job of always finding ROTK and just kind of ignoring the Bristleback and eliminating his teammates.
And this is what generally happens with C-Day, because they get the early lead and then they never look back. Last game, they had to make an adjustment because they were struggling a bit early. They showed their versatility in doing that, Ben, but...